It takes faith to turn loose of something that we really value and to give it to someone else. But as we do that, we begin to discover the benefits of giving. So many benefits exist that many, many individuals do not even recognize as they go through life. So they try to hold and hoard only to discover the disappointment of losing it all. What a blessing it is. That's why God says it's more blessed to give than to receive. He should know. He sent His only begotten Son into this world who gave His very life for you and I to experience the hope of eternal salvation. Let's go to Him in prayer. Father, I'm coming to You right now in the name of Jesus. We're asking You to let the Holy Spirit come down and show us the tremendous benefits in giving, and we'll give You the glory. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Yes, it takes faith to turn loose something that we really want. I want to hold. But as we release that and demonstrate our faith in God that He will indeed provide, we discover the joy of what it is to live free lives. We're no longer possessed by our possessions, but we're free to let His love just be flowing through us, the love of God flowing through us into the lives of so many that are hurting and in need. Paul expressed in Acts chapter 20, verse 35, he said, we must help the weak, remembering the words the Lord Jesus Himself said, it's more blessed to give than to receive. The benefit of giving touches the very core of our existence, enables us to come alive spiritually and connect us with the God, a God who's daily giving us sunshine, giving us the beauty of creation all around us, giving us hope for a future through that empty cross. In fact, we see in Mark chapter 10, verse 43 and 44, whoever wants to be great among you must be your servant. Whoever wants to be the first must be the slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give His life as a ransom for many. That's what the empty cross demonstrates, that Jesus came to give His life as a ransom for many. So if you see someone walking around wearing a nice shiny cross, or maybe you wear such at times, or you just keep a cross in your pocket or whatever it may be, it's to remind us how God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believeth in Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Wow! God gave, and He gives you and I the opportunity to discover the benefits of giving. So we need to open our heart, open our mind, and get into His Word and let Him show us those at this particular moment. But to be honest with you, frequently I don't feel much like getting out of bed, so to speak, and facing 150 to 200 homeless people that are in desperate situations. People that need bus tickets, people that need food, people need hygiene kits, people need clothing. And there's always a few around that aren't very grateful, that get anxious, get upset, get frustrated, and it's never enough. So what do I do in a situation like that? Look beyond those few, and usually they represent less than 5% of the total population. Look at the 95% that are getting direct help. Look at their grateful attitudes. Look at the change that's taking place. And look how God has allowed us to allow His love to flow through us into the lives of others that are in need. Along with that, He gives us a sense of purpose as we give, as we turn loose of those things that we hold so tightly. We then are able to receive with open hands God's blessings. The Lord daily hears the cries of the poor. We are told that in the Scriptures, those that are desperate. And He's constantly looking for yielded vessels that He can bless, and His blessings won't get hoarded, held, and used and misused, but they can flow into the lives of so many that are in need. To experience the benefits of giving, I first have to pray before I engage in service, whether I'm heading out to the streets or reaching out to those that the Lord has me have daily contact with. I must pray, Lord, give me the wisdom, give me the words, and Lord, show me those that have the most urgent need. And then as I allow the Holy Spirit to open my heart and my life, I'm able to just be able to sense His moving. And as I move in accordance with the leading of the Holy Spirit, I frequently see the Lord doing exceedingly abundantly beyond what I can even ask or think. But this love can't flow as long as selfish ambition is a motivating factor for giving. That's why Philippians chapter 2, verse 3 and 4 says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each to the interests of others. When I don't feel much joy from my giving, I have to step back and analyze both my motives for giving my gift and my expectations from the person or group that I'm giving them to. There have been times when I've given a person who is broken, direct help. And instead of being grateful, they sometimes are victims of, of being hurt over and over and over. And they may take that frustration out on me. And when that happens, though, instead of taking it personally, I've got to look beyond that individual into the eyes of my Heavenly Father who gave His only Son for each and every one of us. I have to be able to see that my motives are not just to have that person appreciate what I'm doing, but my motive is we love because He first loved us. And He demonstrated it through that empty cross. And so instead of being disappointed, I should be thankful that God has given me the opportunity to give. And gift needs to be an expression of all the gratitude of what God has given me. And He gives you that same opportunity also. But if you're never giving and always wanting to get, hold, and hoard, you're going to constantly feel a life squeezing everything out of you. Knowing that as you get older and older, you can't take it all with you. And maybe there's greedy kids just waiting to get it and waiting for you to die. Others that are out there. Wow. Let's give while we can. Let's share while we can. Let's reach out. Because Jesus said, don't store up. Give your treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust can destroy. Freely receive, therefore freely giving. Wow, God has given us such a tremendous opportunity. And we continue to see here in Psalm 41:1, it says, blessed is the one who considers the poor, in the day of trouble the Lord will deliver him. Yes, blessed is the one who gives to the poor. In the day of trouble, the Lord will deliver him. Well, I made a reference to this just a moment ago. I want to give you the complete verse, what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 6, verse 19, where He says, do not store up for yourself treasures on earth where moth and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourself treasures in heaven where moth and vermin do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. Storing up your treasures in heaven involves investing your gifts and helping those that are hurting and homeless and in need. For Jesus said, when I was hungry, did you feed me? Naked, did you clothe me? Sick or in prison, did you visit me? He says, after you've done it to the least, He said, even so, you've done it unto me. Our giving doesn't earn us salvation. That's already been provided through the free gift that Christ has made available through His death on the cross, His resurrection. He's paid the price for our sins. It's by His grace that we're saved, not ourselves. It's a gift of God, lest anyone should boast. But once we've experienced that joy of salvation, once we've really come to believe and know that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, we can't help but let that giving be an expression of the gratitude of all that He has given us. It's an act, again, of faith, as I mentioned at the very beginning. It demonstrates that we do believe that every good and perfect gift comes from God above and that He's going to continue to provide. If I sit back and I start looking at the future and worrying, I can just get obsessed by my worries. That's why I have to continue to go back and listen to what Jesus said to learn from the birds. They neither sow nor reap, yet your Heavenly Father takes care of them. So I'll get up early in the morning, sometimes 5 o'clock, 5:30, depending on when the sun comes up, and go out and I look at all the birds. I listen to the birds. I see them hopping around. And I start learning from the birds. They don't know what that day is going to bring, but they know God is going to take care of them. And so I need to trust Him. How about you? Instead of hoarding and worrying and fearful, let's give as He has given unto us. Let's believe God at this particular moment. No one knows what the future holds. No one knows what the economy is going to offer. But to Him who is faithful over little, God will put over much. So as we freely give, the Lord then is free to give to us, and it can just flow, and we can be like a free-flowing stream that just continues to go forth and just continue to share and water that parched earth and the devastating needs, meeting, bringing forth life and hope. And we're not like going into some water flowing into some cesspool that just sits there and gets stagnant. Let's let the water of life flow through us as we give. So God is free to continue to give more and more to us, knowing that we're going to be faithful stewards. We're going to reach out and share. You know, God has given each one of us the opportunity to give. I mentioned financially. How about prayerfully? As you and I pray, we can be all over in the world in so many different places at one time. We can begin to pray. We can pray. I pulled up behind a car today, and that guy's car looked like it was held together by duct tape. And I started just praying for that man. Passed a homeless man on a corner. And when I see him, I try to share it with him. But in this case, all the traffic's backing up. I wasn't able to just get to him, but I was able to pray for him. So you and I can give financially. You and I can pray, and you and I can volunteer, giving of our time, giving of our energy. We offer you many opportunities at New Life Evangelistic Center, because by volunteering, you get to see the homeless directly, and you're able to really share and get to know them as individuals. And for more information on that, go to NLECSTL.org. NLECSTL.org. You can follow us on Facebook, or you can go to put the NLEC TV app on your screen and see homeless people and experience daily. And then you come out and you can volunteer. So you can give financially. You can give through praying, and you can give as a volunteer. We have so many examples in the scripture of such. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 through 4, as we see the joy of giving. And Paul speaking now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability. Entirely unknown, they urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the Lord's people. And they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord, and then by the will of God also to us. These individuals knew the benefit of giving. And they were actually saying, can we give? Can we give more? Can we get more? Because they knew what a difference for good they were making in the lives of others. And they knew they were letting God's light and love flow through them. Are you making a difference for good in the life of someone? Are you letting God's light and love flow through you? Have you discovered personally the benefits of giving? You do, as you see what a big difference for good you make as you serve the Lord, as you let His light and love flow. Freely receive, now freely give, and experience the benefits that come from giving. Are you making a difference in someone's life? Oh, the Lord gives us daily opportunities to do such. And if you want to discover ways that you can directly plug in, again, as I mentioned, go to NLECSTL.org and experience and see all the opportunities available to you at New Life Evangelistic Center. You can volunteer. You can pray. We urgently need your prayers. And you have a tremendous opportunity to give and discover the joy that comes from giving. And as you begin to give, we send you regular letters sharing with you stories and testimonies of people whose lives you have touched, because we want you to discover the joy of giving. You see, there's so many people out there that are facing tremendous needs. And if you and I don't open our heart and mind and, you know, just really share, and I'm not talking about people becoming codependent on you. I'm talking about you giving people a hand up, not just a hand out. Frequently, even when I see somebody over and over on a corner giving, as I engage in conversation and get to know them better, I refer them to resources and places where they can take the necessary steps to break the cycle of homelessness. And much of that also involves a mini training program at the New Life Evangelistic Center. And that's our goal, is to help people break the cycle of homelessness. We give people a hand up, a handout. Now, initially, the handout builds a relationship. But I can't give anything to anybody if I'm only focused on my own problems. I'm only focused on my own needs. And it's so easy for that to happen, because those needs become so real at times. It's hard to pray when you're facing. Remember that earlier passage that I read to you about the Macedonian church? How in the midst of their poverty, in the midst of their need, they not only gave, but they were rejoicing in their giving. And they were looking for opportunities to give even more, because they discovered the benefits of giving. Now, maybe you haven't discovered the benefits of giving. Maybe you're like the little guy that stuck his hand down the cookie jar and couldn't pull it back out because he wanted to grab the last cookie. It's only when we release it and open the hand can we get it back out of the jar. Well, maybe in the jar of life, you're just trying to grab as much as you can and you don't feel like you're really getting anywhere. Discover the joy of giving. And the Bible speaks that over and over. The real joy is a manifestation of the heart of God working through our lives. It's a joy that supersedes circumstances and allows the love of God to be expressed through our lives and the lives of others. It's allowing the love of God to flow through us. I mentioned to you earlier that the Lord hears all these prayers. He hears all these people. He hears people crying out, Lord, I need some water. Lord, I need some food. Lord, I got to get off these streets. And He hears those cries over and over, and then He says, who shall I send? Who shall I send? Frequently, if I'm not really walking with the Spirit like I should, and my worries are overcoming me, and I'm obsessed with this thought, this schedule, that schedule, I'll just miss what God's trying to say. So I have to spend time in the Word daily. I have to spend time in prayer walks daily. I have to just get quiet in my spirit so I can let the Holy Spirit lead me. And then when I meet that particular need, And then as I share with that person in need, you talk about the benefits. I could never have received those kind of benefits by spending my few dollars on something else, or trying to keep up with the neighbors. I mean, people, we do these crazy things to just keep up with the neighbors, and we forget all about giving to others, and we just want to keep up with them. We've got to keep up. Boy, they got this, we got that. I live next door to a neighbor that has a large turtle that comes out and wanders around his backyard. So, do I want to get a bigger turtle than he's got? You know, that's good. People do that with cars. They do that with the way they fix up their house. They do that with everything else. And we totally forget about all the needs that God brings into our lives. So it's very important that we keep our perspective correct. And we never forget that God so loved the world, John 3:16, you know it, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believeth in him shall not perish, but everlasting life. Now, believing in the Lord involves not only trusting him for eternity in his presence, but it means walking with him right now, taking that need and laying it down before God. And Lord, I don't know how this need's going to be met. Lord, I thought it was going to be met yesterday. I was believing it was going to be met yesterday. It wasn't met. You know, as you get older, you step back and you see that sometimes our time schedule is not God's time schedule, but he's an on-time God. And sometimes as you get older, you start praising God for the no's as much as you do the yes's, and you do see that he fulfills his word. He's faithful to his word. As Philippians 4 says, my God shall supply all our needs according to his riches and grace in Christ Jesus. And he's demonstrated that on the cross. Again, back to the cross. The scriptures also tell us that if God would not withhold his own son from the cross, who he died for us and he rose from the dead, will he withhold any good thing from us that we really, really need? The benefits of giving. God gives us that opportunity to be the answer to someone's prayers, to be the angel on the scene, to look to him and watch him do exceedingly abundantly beyond we can even ask or think. So we must get into the Word of God. We must look at the Word of God, see what he's trying to say to us at this time. What are the benefits? 2 Corinthians 9, 12 to 14. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of the Lord's people, it is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God because of the service by which you have proved yourselves. Others will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ and for your generosity in sharing with them, with everyone else, and in their prayers for you, their heart will go out to you because of the surpassing grace God has given you. Thank God. For as he says in Acts 20, verse 35, it's more blessed to give than to receive. There are so many people that would love to be in a position to give at this particular moment. They don't want to have to ask. They don't want to have to be on the receiving end always. They want to give. So God has blessed you. Express your thankfulness to God. That's what giving's all about. It's you saying, thank you, Lord. You know, Thanksgiving offerings they had in the Old Testament, all the different celebrations of the harvest as they gave, demonstrated, we know God has given this, so we want to give it back to him. Now, what did Jesus say? How did he say that we could give back to him? He said, when I was hungry, did you feed me? Naked, did you clothe me? Sick or in prison, visit me? A stranger, did you welcome me? As oft you've done to the least of these, even so you've done unto me. Matthew chapter 25, last part of the chapter. He makes it very clear the benefit of giving gives us an opportunity to directly connect with the Lord as we reach out among his hurting and homeless people. It is true, more blessed to give than to receive. And as he tells us in 1 Thessalonians 5:17, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Rejoice always, Lord, thank you for the opportunity to give. Pray continually for those that are in need. Give thanks in all circumstances and demonstrate it through your liberality and your giving, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Now look for the opportunities that God has put in your world. Do it. Believe him. John 3:16, as I shared over and over with you, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. It brings joy to the Father's heart as we give. In Acts 10, we meet Cornelius. Cornelius was a centurion. He was a Roman. And God used Cornelius to bring the gospel to the world at that time. He and his family were devout. They were God-fearing. We see that whole story in Acts chapter 10. They were generous to those in need and prayed to God regularly. And then about 1 o'clock in the afternoon, Cornelius has a vision. He distinctly sees an angel of God who came and said, Cornelius, Cornelius. And Cornelius stared at him in fear. He says, what is it, Lord? And the angel answered, your prayers and your gifts to the poor have come up as a memorial offering to God. And that's verses 2 through 4 in Acts chapter 10. If we desire to be great in the eyes of God, we need to be great givers. In Acts 10, Cornelius is found giving. He feared God. He believed that his possessions belonged to the Lord and not just to himself. And as the angel told Cornelius, God has seen your giving, go and bring Peter to your home. And the next day, Peter has a vision, and God shows him to go to Cornelius' house. And we see that, and Peter comes with the word of God. And Cornelius' giving resulted in Peter coming to his house. And look what happened in Acts chapter 10, 44 to 47. While Peter was still speaking, sharing the gospel, these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Then Peter said, surely no one can stand in the way of their being baptized with water. They've received the Holy Spirit just as we have. Wow. The Lord saw Cornelius' desire to get close to God. He saw his desire to give, and God responded. In fact, we shouldn't really be surprised, because he tells us in 41, 1 through 3, blessed are those who have regard for the weak. The Lord delivers them in time of trouble. The Lord protects and preserves them. They're counted among the blessed in the land. He does not give them over to the desires of their foes. The Lord sustains them on their sick bed and restores them from their bed of illness. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. And thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that you give us to give. So many benefits exist. And that's why the Lord has entrusted his people. Sure, there's need all over the world. Some people get angry at God. So if you've got a love, why are those people all hurting? He's blessed his people to help them. He's given them that opportunity to discover the benefits of giving, to be the visible presence of the living Christ. Now, to him, much is given, much is required. The scripture tells us, and to him or her, no, to do good and doeth it not, it's a sin. So someday our whole life is going to flash before us, and all the stuff we spent on ourselves, we had opportunities to give. We're going to regret that. Let's not live with our dreads or regrets, but let's look for the hope. And this is the first day of the rest of our life, so let's become a people of giving. And let's ask the Lord to forgive us for all of our stinginess in the past. In fact, we're told in Hebrews 12, 1 to 3, that we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. Let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of the faith, who for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. There was no joy in the cross for Jesus. But he looked beyond the cross. He saw the resurrection. And you and I have that opportunity to be part of the miracle that God is doing at this particular hour. He wants us to experience the benefits of giving. So we come to him right now, and we say, Lord God, please forgive me for all the times that I have hoarded that which you have given me. Thank you, Lord, for giving me the opportunity to be able to give. I want to give you the glory, Jesus, right now. And I want to show that I do believe you. And I want to give. Bring across my path, Lord God, individuals that are hurting, that are in need. And show me, Lord, how I can help them out of my limited resources. How I can just maybe be a friend to those that have no friends. Give a smile to those that have no smile. Help me, Lord, to be able to let your light and love shine in me and through me this day. For the individuals who need the limited money I have, help me to share with them, Lord. And let your light and love flow in me and through me, both now and for all eternity. That's the opportunity Jesus gives us. So let's continue to remember that giving is a benefit. Let's continue to remember that as God gives us these opportunities, he's entrusting us to be able to respond in his love and through his love. Yes, it's truly more blessed to give than to receive. The benefits for giving, why, they're just out of this world. He's made promise after promise to us. So if you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, well, first come and receive that gift of God. It's a gift of God unto salvation. Give your life to Jesus. You'll begin to understand all this that I'm talking about once you know that there is a living Lord. Once you know that there's a Christ who came, who died, and who rose from the dead. And now you and I have been given that wonderful opportunity to share the gospel in word and deed, to share that good news to know that He is with us always, even to the end of the world, to know that God continues to manifest Himself among us through His Word, through the wonders of His creation, all the prophecies have been fulfilled by our resurrected Lord, and so much more. The daily answers to prayer. As you walk with the Lord, as you talk with the Lord, you're going to experience the benefits of giving far beyond what you can ask or think. So, Father, we're coming to You right now. We want to first give You our lives. And then, Lord, we want to follow You, to serve You. Help us at this hour, Lord. For You have freely given to us so much. Help us to be, Lord God, Your channels of love. Help us to go forth knowing that the benefits of giving are out of this world. And it's to You we give all glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.